Diane, I'm listening to a podcast, Black Lodge Trivia Night. I've never heard so many game aspirations in my life.
Welcome back to Black Lodge Trivia Night. This is Art, once again, here with the Bookhouse boys. Matt and Patrick couldn't be here tonight. They are... Well, let's just say what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. So they're not going to be here this week. We're going to do another Bookhouse boys. Feeding off last time we did the M-Space science fiction D100 setting rules, we're going to take a look today at the Hostel setting from Zozer Games. I'll have that information in the show notes. This is for the 2D6 Cepheus rule set. This is the setting book. I'm just going to go through this, and then we're going to talk a little bit about a bunch of different stuff. It says right here, like a Hostel rule book. I'll put this back into the middle, I guess. I don't have this rule book. I probably should get this rule book. I don't have it because, in theory, this is based on Cepheus Deluxe. Cepheus Deluxe is, if you know anything about Mongoose Publishing, they have the rights to the Traveler license. They put out their first edition Traveler, I can't remember when. It had sort of an open gaming license to it. As they moved on, Cepheus came about to sort of keep that license going. So I don't know that, like I said, there is a rule book for this, and there's different... Cepheus isn't a single thing. There's a bunch of different versions of it. Cepheus Deluxe, I think, is sort of the all-inclusive, the most complicated, whatever, version of it. I think they're all compatible. I feel like I probably should have known that going in. So I don't actually have the Hostel rule book. I just have the Hostel setting. And it'll say, like, it's meant to be used with the Hostel rule book. I'll probably pick that up at some point. But it talks about... what you can do with that. It specifically talks about what rulebook you can use. Because again, the Hostel rulebook is an offshoot of like Cepheus Light or Cepheus. There's whole different versions. I'll link to that in the show notes as well, hopefully, but they have different levels of complexity and, yeah, so I never picked it up because I had the Cepheus Deluxe rulebook. But anyway, what we'll say here is it says Cepheus Engine RPG from Moontoad. That's not who published. Anyway, you can get this Samardin Press's free Word doc version, both available at DriveThruRPG. So basically, you can download like a free Word doc that gives you the core rules for this game, and you're set to go. Like I said, I have Cepheus Deluxe. I guess I should have the Hostel rulebook because they do tweak some things and maybe it's useful to know. But anyway, let's get into what Hostel is. Zozer Games. Hostel is essentially a 2D6 setting, 2D6 being Traveler, basically. That is essentially the alien setting without so much of an emphasis on the xenomorphs and the engineers and all that kind of stuff. It's that kind of gritty, dirty, are we getting hazard pay vibe in a setting. Now, I might be sort of on my own on this. I love the first Alien movie. Looking back, I feel like Alien gets a lot less interesting once the alien shows up. All that stuff, all the world building, all the things that are hinted at leading into the arrival of the xenomorph and everything that happens afterward is just like, wow, that's the kind of sci-fi setting I love. And this seeks to capture that. Now, you can get into aliens. It does try and give you the flavor if you want to go more of an alien, full alien kind of game, but you don't have to. So what I wanted to do is, hopefully this won't go quite as long as last time. So I want to go a little bit into the book. And it'll say, like, why is Hostel different? And work. The heroes are workers. There's no heroes or heroes. Heroes are the grunts. They're the skilled labor. The setting is highly industrialized. The setting is very dangerous. It's human-centric. This is a big thing for me. It says no aliens. Well, no intelligent aliens, at least. Again, they add things if you want to add like the classic capital A alien kind of stuff into it. But at its core, it's not meant to be, you know, Babylon 5. It's not even meant to be the alien with the xenomorph that turns everything into, you know, I was about to say it turns everything into like the trope of like the unstoppable evil picks people off one by one. But I was trying to think, I don't know if there's a ton of horror movies that came before Alien in like 1979 or whatever that had that trope where it specifically picks off one by one, like the way like Friday the 13th does. So maybe Alien is the reason why we have all those movies where you have like this basically unkillable bad guy until you need the bad guy to be stopped somehow that just picks people off one by one. Anyway, retrofuturism, this is sort of like the look of 1979's Alien movie. You know, it, like it says even here, like you had Star Wars a few years earlier. Ridley Scott had seen a flat screen technology used in 2001. He chose not to use it. He still went with those curved cathode ray tube kind of, you know, clunky tech. This goes in that direction as well. And then this is sort of a big thing, the cynicism, right? The whole thing, like, are we getting hazard pay? The whole reason why so much of that is like, you know, because there's the big bad corporation, they're stiffing the worker. You know, this isn't in our contract, but they're asking us to do it. You know, like there's a lot of antagonism between the characters you play and who your characters work for. And I think that's sort of an interesting dynamic. You can see the inspiration list, Alien, Aliens, Alien 3. I've never heard of Resurrection, Prometheus, or Covenant. I don't know if those actually exist. But yeah, some really good, you know, Outland's a overlooked kind of classic. It's really interesting, some of the things that are in that movie. I assume The Thing is John Carpenter's Thing, not like the 1950s giant carrot or whatever. But yeah, like Pitch Black, Space Dark. It's just like this gritty, dirty, you know, rich, poor, huge divide, that kind of setting. And it's exactly what I personally love in a science fiction setting myself. But I'm going to try and keep this a little bit shorter than last time, because a lot of this book, you know, again, like they're all going to sort of do the same thing, right? You're going to have your alt history set up to get you to the point where you are. You know, there's tons of flavor going on, you know, the classic eco collapse. Give you a breakdown of like the main nations still on Earth, the main conglomerates. Like, again, like you want to say like this is like giving you Alien without the alien xenomorphs. Right here, you got Leyland Okuda. Leyland Okuda is sort of the main corp, like the main, and Leyland Okuda is Weyland Yutani. You know, it's not that different, you know what I'm saying? So sometimes you're going to feel like this is just a bit of Alien with like the numbers changed, so to speak. But anyway, you got off-world development. Here's one of the things I like. You've got like your basic, this is the setting. I'm a big fan of Traveler 2300. 2300 is a more contained setting than Traveler. Traveler is just too big in my mind to be an interesting setting. This is even more contained, right? You've got your core here, and then you've got like a couple of other sectors. Now, if you're familiar with Traveler, you're going to sort of say, oh, these rectangles, that's probably there for a reason. You got a lot of the symbology and stuff that's not that different than like your classic. If you've played Traveler, you can very easily step into Cepheus Deluxe and this, I keep banging my little mic here. And again, you know, going like, if you're familiar with Traveler, you know, you've seen sector maps like this. It gives you the details. You've got the codes here. C might be like 13, you know, it's like up to 9, and then 10 is A, B, C, D. So same kind of codes, type of planet it is, the hex that it's in. So you can sort of see this is the near Earth zone, and it gives you basically every single sector. So we have near Earth just here, then it goes out to the Fumahot settlement, right? And it just works its way out. Extraction zone 6, frontier planet. You can see much less going on. But again, a lot of detail. Again, you got like other gas giants, other spaceports, stuff like that. Based on the symbology, this means that there's no ocean planet. This means that there is a planet with an ocean. Again, they go through every single section. So you have the full setting, and it's something that I feel is digestible. You know, like Traveler, forget about it. Like it's sort of epic and amazing in scope, But to try and get your head around it, try and wrangle it and, you know, get your ideas going, for me, I found that very difficult. So again, you know, basic world data, you know, they're describing what kinds of things are, what the digits mean. So again, it's very much explaining. If you're familiar with Traveler, it's probably not that different. Catalog of all the off-world. So it's a ton of details. And then here you got some of the core world highlights, right? You got different core worlds that are probably going to be the most important. They give you a little bit of information about the planet, a little bit of information of how it got to be what it is. I kind of find this interesting. It's a little bit broad in a sense, obviously, because it's just two paragraphs. But what I like about this kind of approach is that if you're the kind of person that sort of starts, I think I talked about this in M Space, where like you get books that really like start to spark your imagination and stories, like, oh, I wonder if that, or I connect, this connect, that connects. I feel like this is giving you a lot of opportunities for that to happen, because there's just tons and tons and tons of detail about the setting as a whole. 2300 has the beanstalk. This has the trans-atmospheric petroleum pipeline, the TAP. So basically, instead of having a cargo beanstalk like in 2300, they have running from Brazil to orbit just a giant pipe for oil. And you're thinking, oil, why do we still need oil? You don't need oil for fuel. They make it a point to explain that you need oil for plastics, basically. And so, and I think it even says in here, and I confess I don't remember this, the mission that the ship in the first Alien movie was on was to bring back like 200 million tons or whatever of oil. It was an oil ship bringing back that resource to Earth. I believe that's the case. They described it in here, but I obviously did not rewatch the movie. But yeah, it's basically just tons and tons of planets. All of like, you know, what's on the planet that would make it interesting is under the planetology development. You know, again, if you look at the history and see what the conflicts are that are arising on the planet, what could be sort of used to fuel future conflicts or stories, it's all there. Then you get into the Outer Rim world highlights, right? Because now there's going to be a lot less, but again, if you're seeing this, this is definitely something I used to see in 2300, like the old GDW books. I assume in Traveler they use a similar thing, but anyway, so, you know, they talk about different planets, frontier worlds, you know, again, just like we're on page 78 and we're still getting more and more and more background. They talk about, this is interesting, you know, they talk about inside the conglomerate. So how do businesses work, right? Like, what's the structure? How do they, you know, have a hierarchy? It's all these things so that, again, if you wanted, if you are the type of person that detail sparks connections, that spark story ideas, this is just bombarding you with tons and tons of detail about this setting. Now, one thing I guess you could say is that sometimes it feels like those influences they list at the beginning of the book are a little bit more than just influences. It's just like, we'll get to something in the minute, but like Weyland-Yutani, like the main corporation, is sort of that kind of vibe. Leyland Okuda, right? You could say, you know, it's like, it's the Shinning, you know, we're not going to get sued, right, from The Simpsons. So I think you can make the argument that sometimes maybe it's just like, eh, but you know what, for whatever it's worth, like, I feel like, again, these are all the corporations. My intention, again, isn't to go like page by page and hand model this into a creepy level, but it's just so you can get like just tons and tons of flavor so that even if you're not using it to make connections, when you get to a planet, you can look up what the planet has and you can see a bunch of details and you can get started. The United States Marine Corps is another group, you know, again, because while you're playing grunts, there's different kind of grunts you can play, right? Like there's the sort of corporate grunts, but they make it so you can play like soldiers as well, right? Space Command. The thing you're not going to be is you're never going to be like the above the clouds kind of rich, and you're never going to be people at the top. You're meant to be just the lowest of low in this universe, and I love that. Again, the Starline, it's just nonprofit organizations. It's just you look up the stuff that you need when you need it, and you get like tons of information. Criminal organizations, Texas cartel, snakeheads. The one that jumped out at me was the Lebkuchen. So members of the German Lebkuchen are genetic activists, fighters for the rights of cloned human beings. There's a couple things. One, if you get here, they talk about how, do they call the snakeheads? Are snakeheads the replicants? Or are snakeheads somebody else? Maybe it's just another crime syndicate. But basically the idea is like, in this universe, there are replicants. They rebelled against a certain group. They killed everybody. They can't be trusted. They can't be saved. So you have to execute replicants on site. I mean, that's the plot of Blade Runner. That's sometimes what I was saying about how, like, you know, sometimes it feels like it's just, you know, it's not like a 100% completely unique top to bottom setting, but it gives you all of the tropes that you would want for these kinds of science fiction settings. I'm a firm believer, and I don't know if I'm crazy for thinking this, but when you get into this kind of science fiction, anytime you are in an urban area, like sort of in a developed-ish urban area, you're cyberpunk, right? Cyberpunk and this kind of sci-fi to me are not distinct. They are one and the same, because if you're in a city, you're doing cyberpunk, because that's just how I feel the tech's going. Lebkuchen in German, a family that is from Germany, and every Christmas, Lebkuchen is gingerbread men. Every Christmas in our house, we have this weekend where we're just cranking out Lebkuchen for the holidays to get it out to relatives. So I thought that was kind of funny that that's what the group was called. But anyway, so then what you get to do is like, what kind of character are you going to play? So here we're on page 112. So the first 111 pages are just the setting, like who we are, where we are, what's there, just tons and tons of detail of the setting. Who we are tells you the kind of characters you can play: colonists, corporate investigators, freelance miners, commercial starship crew, marines, resource exploration team, PMCs, private military contractors. Looks like you can do an android. Then you start to get into character creation. Even though this is a setting book, I guess I'm a little surprised this isn't in the hostile rulebook. But they put it here, which is, I guess, again, part of why I never grabbed the rulebook with Cepheus Deluxe. But they give you everything you need to make your character here in this setting. It's typical, like, 2D6 Traveler-esque stuff. You pick your careers, you roll your stats. Your stats are pick starting skills. And then you have sort of, and this is true in Cepheus Deluxe, you sort of have like a sort of life path system. Nothing is like the original Traveler, even I think the modern versions of Traveler with Mongoose, like second edition, nothing is quite as brutal as the original Traveler. So you can have mishaps in your life path, but you cannot die, which again, a lot of people will be like, what? Come on. Dying is the whole point of like character creation in the original 77 Traveler. But so you can have mishaps, you muster out, you sort of get personal development. You can take careers over and over and over again until you are forced to muster out. Or I guess you could choose. But, you know, basic thing, marshals, military spacers, marine, commercial spacer, corporate exec. Corporate exec might be as high as you can go. But you can see it takes like a really special qualifier. So that's what you need to, that might be like GM's permission kind of thing. Like, do you want to let somebody be that? Ranger, physician, rogue, roughneck, you know, very basic, classic, not basic, but classic scientist, survey scout, technician. So here you get to see the character sheet. stats are your typical 2d6 traveler: strength, dex, endurance, intelligence, education, social. I think the way damage works in Cepheus is a lot like that. Like, you first, I think, reduce one stat, either strength or dex, then you go to the next one, then you go to endurance, and once you get to like the bottom of all three, then you're dead. Armor absorbs, like, blocks damage from getting through, as God intended, not this AC abstraction. So I like that. There is no hit locations as in M space, but that's okay. You just sort of simplify it a little bit. That's fine. Although I wouldn't say 2d6 systems are simple. I find them pretty robust. I think actually M space is a simpler system than Cepheus in my mind, but it's been a while since I've played in a 2d6 system. I don't think I've ever actually run a 2d6 system now that I think about it. I've definitely played old school 2300 AD and Traveler, and I think some Mega Traveler, you know, tabletop. Then there were like these old Mega Traveler video games. They weren't that good, but I did play those for a while when I was a kid. You got your skills, you got your classic jack of all trades, but it's just the typical, like, if you've seen Traveler, you've seen the skill list in some level. You know, tactics is a skill you can use at the beginning, I think, of combat to give yourself a little bit of an initiative bonus if you want. Then you got your equipment. Armor, it's just, again, armor rating, that's how much, like, damage is going to block. You got weight. You got, you know, different kind of communicators. Again, it's just very, very classic stuff. Here you're seeing, like, you know, when it's, like, retro tech. This is retro tech by today's standards, right? You know, you got, like, sort of, like, these optical discs for storage. Monitors are, like I said, CRTs, so they're clunky. They might be monochromatic, like that sort of green monochrome. You can, again, software, medicine, designer drugs, which I kind of like that, and I think 2300 might go into this as well, but I like the idea that it goes into a little bit of, like, dirt, like dexamphetamines, you know, speed. Because again, this might be something that a grunt might use to push through that second shift or something to make the money, make the extra money. They give you, like, robots, drones. They give you androids. They give you how to custom build androids. Again, a lot of this, you know, also is in M space. This is, you could argue, a different version of it. I would argue that this is a sort of grittier and more specific version, which is good, because this isn't trying to be like a general sci-fi rule set the way M Space was. Like, M Space was trying to let you do whatever you want. This is its thing. This is cued and designed for a setting, tuned to a setting. So they can get very specific. They give you little brand leaders, again, as a little bit of flavor for the types of companies, which I always liked, because, like, in 2300 AD, it wasn't just that the gun was the assault rifle. It was like a, you know, I forget what the kind was. You know, here again, you would get, it's not just the ration pack. It's the Kanako Sunrise, right? You know, it's just something that makes it a little more, you know, flavorful, feel a little more real in a way. You got tools, you got survey kits. Again, one of the adventures I played as a kid in 2300, we were doing like a planetary survey, and the idea of it fascinated me. The idea of, like, landing on it and then mapping out. It was my first maybe hex crawl. You know, the map sort of looked like that map I showed you earlier on. If I can find it real quick, probably can't. It wasn't the sector maps. It was the hex grid planetary surface map. And I remember, like, we were tasked with not just doing the adventure, we were tasked with filling in, like, mountain, grassland, stuff like that. I don't know if it worked very well at the time, because I was a little kid. Well, wasn't that little, but I was more used to the idea of, like, you know, who do I shoot and where do I smash? And we were presented with this more esoteric task set before us, and I liked the idea of it, but At the same time, I don't know. I think it was also the GM's first time sort of ever running like this kind of hex crawl. And I don't know if they quite knew what to do with it. We didn't quite know what to do with it as players. And so it sort of fizzled. But that was one of my first encounters with 2300. And it really, really opened my eyes to the idea that role-playing games don't just have to be like Hulk Smash. They can be something more. Again, you're going to get to vehicles. Artwork looks like, I'm trying to figure out what this, I don't know if this is like Blender kind of stuff. I like it. Like it definitely gets the job done. Some of it looks like hand-drawn. Some of it looks like 3D modeling. Melee weapons, firearms. Again, you're going to get the automat Kaliningrad AKZ-4. It's not just like machine gun, right? So I like that little bit of Stern Weapons, Williams Auto. So you just sort of, I think it connects you when you start giving names to things, it sort of connects you to the setting instead of Vibro Sword B, you know? Singapore Arms SA-66. So, it covers all the basics, shotguns. Anything that you want from like a traveler kind of 2300 AD setting, this gives you in spades. With that proper level of like filth, which I like. Flamethrowers, it's not too fancy. We're not getting into like laser blasters. Again, the setting is only like a couple hundred years in the future. And it obviously, based on some of the things you saw in the beginning, it's our planet. We're not on some mythical Star Wars Tatooine where, it's Earth, it's the core world. You split the sectors up, Euro, American, Japanese. 2300, I think, does it France, America, China, or the ESA or something. For some reason, in 2300, France becomes like one of the superpowers. I think it has to do with like how they get to where they are, like wars break out and stuff like that, and France maybe manages to avoid them. I don't know, but here the United States, I think, maintains its elite status. So here's where it gets into like wages and prices, right? So you're gonna get an idea of like what a roughneck's gonna grind out. You're gonna get how much it costs to do stuff. You're gonna get monthly salaries. You're gonna just get dirt. And the reason why, like, it might seem like these are just like, oh my God, I gotta worry about these numbers. Yes, maybe. But what I could see it being is a way to, very detailed way to sort of put that pressure on your characters, because they're supposed to be poor. They're supposed to be poor. And maybe the big score on the dangerous shipping run is, enough of motivation to get them to do something. Take risks, stuff that could become plot. So then here in the next section, they give you advice for running the game. They give you some bullet points of like types of things you can do. Miners at a small test rig have all come down with some mystery illness. Take a doctor out there to find out what it is. It doesn't give you any more. It's just little seeds. Ship 1,000 tons of titanium building struts to start up a colony. To a startup colony on arrival, there's no colonists investigating. Again, just little bits. They give you a simplified squad combat, so you don't have to do the full combat if you want Cepheus Deluxe, because it's Cepheus Deluxe. It's not crazy, but it's not stupid simple. They give you tips. I did like this, the Murphy's Law of Combat. Like this, because again, it sort of sets the kind of flavor this game is going for. The more stupid the leader is, the more important the mission is he's ordered to carry out. I feel like this is a classic thing. Like if you've been in the military or, you've been in certain professions, you're like, oh yeah. No matter which way you have to march, it's always uphill. Things that must be together to work usually can't be shipped together. So, you can see it's sort of like, it reminds the GM in my mind to like, anything that can go wrong should go wrong is what it comes down to. And it gives you sort of, classic ways to encapsulate that. You can explore. There's describing the setting. You know, this I appreciate this stuff because, you know, who knows if everybody's seen Alien at this point. And so it kind of gives you the idea of like yellow post-it notes. Yellow post-it notes might be the item in my recent role-playing that caused the most stupid fun. I'll get into it a little bit more at some point, but whenever I do a science fiction, it started with a game that Matt here at Black Lodge Trivia Night ran. He was running an alien campaign. Somehow post-it notes became this fixation of like, because in that game, I think certain people would go into cryogenic sleep while other people would be up and doing stuff. So I think you would take shifts. And so, and because they have all these mechanics for like, you know, ship degradation and things breaking down, anything that would cause stress to the crew, you know, the on-duty shift would be leaving like very passive-aggressive post-it notes for the old shift and stuff like that. And so now that I'm running like my M-Space campaign, which is technically in using the Savage Worlds rule set at the moment, although it did start as M-Space rules for a really long time. I appreciate that. But yeah, the idea is that like, look, you know, again, it's not like virtual Minority Report interfaces. It's blast doors. It's overhead equipment junctions. It's crates. It's just junk. And so I appreciate, at first I was like, ah, you know, I don't know, but I appreciate it because again, it's much like the Murphy's Law of what can go wrong should. This is a reminder that like, hey, it's not going to be like pristine, white, futuristic XYZ. It's going to be like a single light bulb barely lighting the room. It's going to be a monitor that's like this big and has no color except for the color green and the black background. Like, it's just a reminder, like, you know, the phone's going to be wired sometimes, you know, things like that. They give you some iconography if you want. You can, you know, use this for maps, I guess. So then it gets into Crew Expendable the Horror. Now, while Hostel isn't necessarily designed to only do horror, they're like, look, you know, you might want that, right? So Hostel lends itself to horror perfectly. Like I said, for me now, when I think back on it, the movie Alien gets a lot less interesting once the alien shows up. And so for me, I'm always looking for sci-fi settings that don't require, that don't have this horror baggage attached to it. I'm currently in with the Alcoholic Avenger Cabal, like a mothership campaign. And I'm enjoying it very much. But if I were to run a science fiction game, aside from M-Space, I would probably move away from something like Mothership, even though it works pretty well, because the sort of horror, I think, is so ingrained in the setting. And here, they're like, look, if you want to do it, you know, here's some tips. And the tips, you know, they're not so like, oh my God, I never thought of that. You know, it's understanding that horror involves isolation and certainty. It's just, you know, classic reminders of what the ingredients are that can make good horror, the sort of the tropes that are underneath the tropes, if you know what I mean. Exomorphs, xenomorphs, again, if you want to put these in here. It's fine. But this is not what I'm here for, but I appreciate that, like, they want to cover all their bases. So they, you know, put some details in here. But so this is, but this is part of why, because it's just like a renamed xenomorph, right? You can see from the picture. So in my mind, it's just like, look, it feels like it's, pandering is too strong of a word, but it just means like we're just doing it to include it. And we know this is what you want. Run with it. And I wish that either they did something else with it, they did something more with it. I think that's one takeaway I have from this, is that whenever they're sort of clearly borrowing from something else, I wish that they put their own little spin on it, because I feel like they
have sort of put their own little spin, a big spin, on the setting as a whole. So I just wish that there was a little bit more to it, I guess, if it's going to be here. But then again, I would never use it anyway, right? They do give you other monsters. I found this actually a little more interesting, because here's maybe where you put a little bit more spin on it. Well, I mean, the idea that, you know, faster than light travel in the hostile setting uses hyperspace. So you find weak spots in the time-space continuum or whatever, and you sort of punch through in those spots. Those spots are sort of predetermined, you know, like they've been explored and figured out. And I like this lens. Again, part of the reason why I wanted to do another one of these is I wanted to practice. You can see, like, the GoPro, I remembered that they have, like, color settings, so I changed the color balance. So now I don't look like whatever I looked like last time. Now I look like my normal pasty garbage self. And I think my lens has autofocus engaged, and so that might be intensely annoying, and I apologize for that. Probably should have turned that off, or I should have told it, hey, like, focus on the center of the frame. Anyway, that's one more thing to learn for the next time we do Bookhouse Boys. Anyway, so this type of horror introduced here is if you... it's the hyperspace horror, right? It's like, what happens when you go through hyperspace? Do people go crazy? Does it damage electronics? Does it... do you come into contact with just general weird? And sometimes it gets really weird, like mirror universes. Like, these could be like... some of these could be good seeds for a Star Trek episode. Some of them is like star vampires. You're like, okay, whatever. That's the kind of stuff I don't actually care about. But then it gets into this kind of stuff. So aside from all the details about the setting, the world, which you could argue might be like slightly reskinned alien lore or whatever, I wouldn't go that far, but, you know, if you're trying to be uncharitable, I guess you could say, but it's just so much work has gone into it. So I feel like it's a lot more than that. This is the stuff I actually really like. This is sort of going into the minutia, the grit of blue collar space working for a living. And so here you go, the zero G workplace. You know, you got to lock your umbilical, you got a grab pad, you got handheld thrust. It's probably something, if you were in a movie, you'd see it all in a picture. But here, like, it just gives you all the little details of what it's like to do, like, the job in space. Like, what happens if you lose pressure? You know, zero G toolkits, a grappling arm that can swing you out, you know. Speed of decompression, time to asphyxia. It's detailed, but again, like, you know, other systems might like hand wave it away or something. This one doesn't, and I appreciate it because, again, the detail and the grit of being this blue collar hump is the game. So, you know, I want this to be in the game. I want these details, whether or not I use them, whether or not I remember them in the moment. I want the details there so that I can use it. Like, you get, you know, so effects of the vacuum on a human body. You're conscious for 12 seconds, convulsions, blood pressure plummets. You know, it's gruesome, but, you know, it's just detail. Like, even this, which I don't know if you necessarily need. This is basically how an airlock works. You got the door, you got handles, windows, you know, the locks, the override, you know, it describes like the details of what like a simple airlock door is like, so that you have that information at the ready in case you can use it in some narratively important way. And it's tuned to this gritty, low tech for sci-fi setting. I appreciate that, because a lot of this stuff, we'll get more of this into in a little bit, you could use anywhere, right? Like, you don't have to use this setting. Say you wanted to have like an Expanse RPG, right? but you want it to be like super gritty, super dirty. All this information is still relevant. Some parts of it wouldn't be like, you know, like the hyperspace and stuff like that, but a lot of it you could absolutely use. Asteroid mining, again, like how does it work? Like going into the details of like, what are the steps? What would you be going after? You know, what might be a typical mission? Prospecting, traveling to the rock, touchdown and anchor, extraction. Gives you yields, like tables if you want. You can, you know, again, you could use these tables anywhere. The tonnage, any special yield. I wouldn't use alien artifacts, but whatever. Then they give you, again, mining problems, and you're supposed to roll one of these like every start of every day or something, I think. Because, again, it's supposed to be a dangerous, hazardous job. Starship construction, you know, they give you, again, part of me is surprised this is not in the rules, the hostile rules, but I guess they're assuming you might not have the rules. You might be using the Cepheus, you know, I guess they want to make that possible. But again, very detailed rules as you would expect in like a classic Traveler game. And this is part of what I was saying in M-Space where like, and this is why I feel like M-Space is a little simpler, because there's just everything to this game is just a lot. And I think the people who are drawn to this type of game, as I actually often am, as a, maybe a player, as a GM, maybe I just don't have the mental capacity at this point to do it, but you want that detail, right? You need that detail. Because without me, you're on the wall, whatever. Bad attempt to quote Jack Nicholson. But it's just tons and tons of detail for your ship, because I know I've done it. I know players who part of the fun is spending hours designing the ship. I've done it a few times and had a blast with like classic Traveler 2300. Anyway, weapon mounts, 50 ton bays. Again, this isn't important. Just the point is that it's all here and it's all sort of nicely connected to this style, this grit, this kind of setting. Towing, not something you get in every sci-fi game, but it would be important here because the types of game, types of players you are. Small craft design, and it's very hard sci-fi, right? Like you're doing M-drive tonnage. I think M-drive is going to be like the hyperspace. Oh, maneuver drive, and then power plant. Okay, so I guess this is like getting around a system. So yeah, it's very hard sci-fi. It's, you know, you're using tonnage. You're not using like more abstract points, stuff like that. Much fuel you need in 12. Like it's just so, it's very detailed. Then they give you a bunch of ships, and they like I said, they've got these sort of like flavor pieces throughout the book where they give you like an advertisement, like in world. In setting that just sort of gives you a lot of flavor. Different types of ships, they, you know, military ships, the USS Colorado. Again, it's the details of this aren't the specific details aren't the most important thing. And then they give you mission reports. Here's, you know, it says 30 scenario outlines, most of which can be set anywhere in the hostile universe. So again, more seeds for an adventure. And I think they sort of, like when they describe, I don't know if it was in like the certain things back here, trying to remember where it was, they'll talk about like maybe different, yeah, like the corporations, they'll give you like a scenario seed. So they're giving you a little, the GM, they're giving you a little bit of a secret about what's going on in the corporation that you might be able to expand into something further. Some of these are Comet Inbound, like one of them is literally the plot to the movie Armageddon. Like there's an asteroid coming in and you gotta get a crew up there to plant nukes on it. Deadly impact. So again, like sometimes, you know, but you know, that might be enough to get yourself a story going, and then you can sort of tweak it as needed. They give you different stuff. Let's see, these look like NPCs, general like NPC stats. What are these? Upstream report. This looks like couple of new ships, you know, what it's like on board, like a large ship, the USCS Goliath, give you some blueprints. Anyway, so that's a quick overview of the book Hostel. And again, like I said, the book is almost wall-to-wall setting and flavor material that you can use for campaign in the setting, or if you want to just borrow the general information to put into your sort of lower tech, retro tech, retro future, gritty, you know, sci-fi. But that's not what all I want to get into. There's a bunch of, I don't have all the books. Like I said, I don't have the rule book. There's tons of books. So the next, what I want to show is some of the supplements I thought was really cool. So here's something called Dirt Side, right? So again, used for, and there's more than I have, but I grabbed some that were very specific to what I'd be interested in. So this is, Dirt Side is a book that's geared toward comprehensive wilderness survival. The reason why I grabbed this is, again, talking about that campaign that my friend ran, 2300, where we were sort of exploring hex by hex. I felt like it kind of fizzled, and here I saw, I was like, oh, maybe there's, you know, more detail that you could use to keep things interesting, right? You know, you've got different random tables, I think, for the type of area you're in, if that's, you know, event tables, things like that. Just stuff to get you more details about, like, the moment-to-moment. Of, you know, crossing like an alien planet, you know, vehicle, you know, just tons of stuff. Not tons, but it gives you, this is, I thought, like a way to organize it, which I know sounds dumb, but even if you don't use the sheets, I feel like what it does is it can provide you a framework as the GM. You can be like, oh, I see. Okay. It gives you a way to, it helps you, like I was saying with M-Space, if you start picturing ideas starting to coalesce, these are the types of things that can help you sort of, like I was saying, give you a framework to start imagining like how everything could fit together. But yeah, it gives you a lot of just detail on what it would be like to cross an alien planet surface, so that if you're running that kind of adventure, you might be able to use some of that to spark some ideas. It even, you know, again, it gives you, not that you need to do this, but, you know, it gives you what you need to create your own random events tables if you need it for any reason. When you buy something, I think these I got printed at lulu.com. I think that's the main way Zozer prints stuff. If you buy it at lulu.com and you email them and say, hey, I bought this at Lulu, they'll send you the PDF of the document. So it's incredibly easy to get the PDFs at no extra charge. I love that about these books. So when you buy this book, you can then also, you'll get the PDF and then you'll have these sheets for whatever you need. Dirt Side, the other one, another one I got was Roughnecks. Because again, I'm not looking so much for the military stuff. I'm looking for like the crew of the first Alien movie. So Dirt Side. Roughnecks, Miners and Prospectors, again, it's going to give you more detail into mining surveys. Again, and I think that's important because otherwise it could be, it's something you probably could do with just a couple of rolls. But if you're not going to do that, if the game is going to be this, then it's a matter of, you know, you do the minutiae, right? So again, this gives you target types. It could be a comet, it could be moon. Just again, moon or planet, gives you a little detail about that. It gives you the steps of a mission profile with maybe a little more detail. Travel to the drill site. You remember we were talking about the scan, travel, touchdown, geological survey. Gives you some like mining platforms. It shows you sort of how it works. Potentially, you know, stuff like that. So it gives you a lot of detail so that you can start fleshing out your descriptions, and maybe this diagram says, oh, this breaks and that gives, or the water tank does X and that's giving me an idea for this or that or the other thing. So yeah, asteroid mining, refining, you know, so they give you a bunch of information like that. What's the next one I got? Gunboats and shuttles. Again, not that I specifically care about military vehicles, but I just wanted to have a plethora of layouts so that if I needed to just drop one into an adventure, I'd be like, okay, I got a heavy lift shuttle, great. I don't have to think about it. I can rename it whatever I want. But if I need the layout, if I need the blueprint, it's there. And so I just got this as sort of like a catch-all to get a better idea of the kinds of ships as well. So you don't just have the few that they provide in the main game. But that was it. It was just to have like a blueprint so I could drop them in as a moment's notice. Or not a moment's notice, but if I'm like, okay, you know, prepping for this week, I know I'm going to need like a surface to orbit shuttle. Okay, let me just grab one and we're good to go. You know, just to get basic ideas like that. So I guess this is interesting. I have an RPG upstairs that. So this explains flight operations, right? And it's sort of, again, because it's kind of a crunchy system. It'll say here, like a small ship has 12 burns, large ships have 24 burns. And it's a way to abstract, you know, fuel consumption, which I appreciate, even though so much of this is not abstracted. But yeah, you got burns required, so it's like leave orbit for 4, decelerate 4. So even if you only got 12 burns, you're going to need 8 to do the basics of launching from a planet and coming back or slowing down on the other end. So it just gives you, you know, again, something to manage. It's all these details to keep track of because, again, that's this game. Couple more here. Explorers, again, this is a whole book about getting out there, landing on alien planets, doing surveys. I think this goes nicely hand in hand with Dirt Side. I think these two maybe pair well together. So maybe that's part of why I did it. You got, again, these ads. Gives you a little bit more detail into equipment used for exploration. So I appreciated that as well. You can design your own spacesuits if you want to get into that kind of minutia. Yeah, it's just, there's nothing here. So, and this might be my own problem. Survey problems, again, another, it's always good to have more random tables. I am the type of person that would rather have too much information than not enough. And so when I tend to go into a system, I tend to go mostly all in. I tend to like, okay, the more books I have, the better, because I don't know where I'm going to grab something from. And so I just enjoyed the idea of, you know, having a book that, because again, going back to that original 2300, the problem is that we sort of fizzled. So I wanted to have stuff that could help us overcome that. Did I showed Roughneck? And then this is something they might have more of. I wish they gave you some adventures. What I like about this one in particular is that Pioneer Station, I won't get too deep into what it is, but there's two parts to this. One is that they give you a station, which could be used on its own, right? You know, so it gives you details of what a station is like, but then it gives you an adventure. Now, the adventure, though, it says right in the front, it's a horror adventure. Again, I think that's sort of like, you know, when you get like a, you know, Patrick, myself, Matt, we started as war gamers. Why does every World War II system have like a Normandy invasions? Because it's just classic, everybody know, or Battle of the Bulge. I feel like this is that, like, every sci-fi game needs to have some kind of horror component. So, you know, this is the kind of adventure. I wish that the rule book, the setting book, maybe came with some more. I don't know if this is reasonable. Like, it's because it is a setting book, right? And so it is chock full of setting. It just gives you so much setting. I wish it gave you a little bit of a pointer. It gives you a lot of story seeds, but I wish it did come with like a starting adventure or something. And I actually think that kind of gets rectified in Hostel Solo. I've been looking at this actually a lot recently. I've been, you know, I'm always sort of prepping something, and I've been sort of doing some of the data entry into Foundry for Hostel Solo. So I'm hoping at some point, someday I can try it. And this might be worth getting even if you don't intend to play solo, and I'll explain why. Again, D66, this might be the same survey problem in the other book. Encounter tables. It's just stuff like that can help you as a GM, you know, even when you're playing with PCs. Alien inspirations. It's just tons of stuff that can help point you with how to go. And this is what I was about to say. Because after you get through all the rules of, you know, random tables for worlds, stuff like that, just if you need to get one going on the quick, you know, again, like stuff that could actually be useful to a GM. I thought this was interesting. They give you this method for creating stations that's meant to be very quick. And so because I feel like this is meant to be like a sandboxy kind of setting, I feel like all these tools could help just a normal GM sort of flesh out a universe. So what you do when you sort of come up to a station is you create like 9 nodes. You don't have to make a very detailed map. It's just to get the idea. And then, you know, the number of decks. So if it's 3 decks, it's 3 decks of 9 nodes. You can arrange them however you want. And then there's tables for what those nodes can be, right? And so in my mind, like, this is a great way, like, we're going to travel to this sector, but you didn't, oh, crap, I didn't plan that out. And there's going to be, okay, the sector map says that there is a space station here. Okay, crap. What size is it? Okay, okay, boom. So suddenly you got that. And next thing you know, you're very quickly like, okay, let me just dot, roll. And next thing you know, you've got yourself a station. And it might not be the most elaborately mapped out thing, but it can be done so quick. And it can be done, like, these are sort of colony outposts. Again, it's like 3 sets of 6 nodes, right? So you can arrange them however you want. You put airlocks in there somewhere. But you see what I'm saying? Like, it's a very quick way to flesh out a setting, whether you're playing it solo or not. And then the other thing, this is the other thing that I think really comes through that could be helpful for any GM. You know, they give you some hints and teases about different things in the core rulebook and like in the supplements. But here's where they say, like, okay, you want to do a shipping campaign. So you got, which is basically the plot of the first Alien before the Alien shows up. You know, they're running cargo. And so, okay, well, how do I, because the rulebook doesn't say, like, here's an adventure to get you started, or here, you know, here's a lot of detail to help you, you know, get used to what you're running. This does, you know, let you create like the hauler, you know, again, using the simple system. And then it gives you a checklist, you know, and again, you could keep this from the players. You don't have to share this with them, but you could just say, okay, what am I doing? Okay, you got a random mission. Because at some point, like, you know, like, what are they going to haul? I guess it doesn't really matter. You know what I mean? So it's all these different tables that could help you flesh out, you know, a transportation mission. What do they call this? A shipping mission, right? You know, and like, where are you going? What are the passengers? You know, it's just like tons and tons of detail that I feel like, I guess this is the Kevin Crawford genius, right? Like, if you're getting like, you know, Worlds Without Numbers and stuff like that, it's tons and tons of tables. But you could roll up a bunch of tables or look at the list and sort of see what sparks your imagination, because I don't know how many adventures there are like Pioneer Station pre-published. There might be a ton. You know, if you just go to Zozer, you know, again, I'll put it in there. I'm sure it lists it. But this sort of alleviates the main issue I was having with the setting book, which is I don't know where to start. Here, you know, I could say I want to do a shipping campaign, and okay, now I've got something to work with that helps get me going. Encounters, you know, just like tons and tons of stuff. And again, I know this is meant for solo, but like all of this could be used to generate missions as a GM. And so I highly, if it were me, and obviously this is what I did, I grabbed the solo book intending to say, oh, maybe I can try it solo, but I absolutely recommend it for GMs. If you have the ability to grab it, it can give you a lot of useful information to get you going. Survey campaigns. This one, again, would have been really helpful because this is the one that petered out on us in 2300. These, I don't think, are probably easy to run, right? But here you get like a bunch of different tools, again, to flesh out the detail, give players something to do, because then that sort of populates the local setting enough to start sparking ideas, right? You know, and again, this is the job. This is the game. It's the grit. It's the minutia. How to locate survey targets, guard, you know. Again, just tons and tons of detail that I feel like could walk you through multiple sessions of like a hostel, and then you could just string them together, right? If there is really a lack of published material adventures like this. So they have stuff for, you know, surveys, shipping, colony survival, which means, you know, you're sent to a colony that's struggling. There's also military, marine squad. There's like your troubleshooting group for a corp. Asteroid mining, this is another one I'd look at again, you know, because I would sit there and say, like, I want to run a game where you play a bunch of asteroid miners, but I would then get stuck. I wouldn't know what to do next. And so this can really sort of, I think, get you over that hump and get you started. Colonial missions, et cetera, et cetera. Anyway, so that's a quick look at Hostel, but I guess I have to be careful where I stick my arms. But what I want to do now is I sort of want to give this a little bit of a broader context. I really like the idea of this setting, and I did struggle with it a little bit until I got Hostel solo. Once I got this, I was like, okay, I could get this, I feel like, off the ground and running really easily now. Where before I was like, that's why I kept buying books. I'm like, okay, I'm not quite at a place where like a grand storyline's coming together or something like that. But then, or how I would get this started, like the something wasn't quite clicking. Then I got this, and then I realized, okay, this is good. This is what I would need to get this off the ground. The question though is, Hostel is a game that's probably in the RPG realm, probably not completely ubiquitous. But a game that probably is a little bit more ubiquitous is Free League's Alien, right? And one of the recent books is Building Better Worlds. And Building Better Worlds kind of brings to Free League's Alien what Hostel does, right? I feel like there's a lot of overlap. If you look at the books, you've got, again, like, how did we get here? Timelines of alt history. You've got the list of government organizations, corporations, Weyland-Yutani, you know, a lot of like doing the same work, right? How to make your blue collar people, again, just like Hostel, that's what comes next, you know, different types of stuff. Gear, again, just like Hostel, you know, all the kind of stuff that sort of brings it a lot closer to the ground in terms of like exploration equipment, vehicles. Out of mine, you know, again, but now I will say this, the Hostel book is, I feel like, a more hard sci-fi RPG, and this obviously, like, Free League, they're not making hard sci-fi anything. The settings might be, but the mechanics won't be, so it's going to be a lot easier to play. Which might be like systems and colonies, again, a lot like Hostel. And the thing that they do in this game that something I was just saying I wish would happen in Hostel is when you get to a certain point. That was Xenomorphs. Bah, bah, bah. They give you a campaign. They give you a 7-part story to run. You know, like, hey, like, we're going to give you something so that if you buy this book and you have the role-playing game, you're going to have everything you need to do to run a game for quite a long time. So on some level, you're thinking, oh, well, then, you know, I just get Alien. And here's the thing, though. This is still Alien, the role-playing game, and so it's still going to be heavily loaded with the importance of, like, the engineers and the xenomorphs, and they call them something in this that's probably a lot more specific. And that's the kind of stuff I'm not that interested in. But what I will say is, though, to their credit, they give you a lot to work with. So if you're looking to run a campaign where you're playing the crew of the Nostradamus, which I guess you could do with the base game, because the game that Matt ran, and maybe it's just because we took it over and turned it into this, but when Matt ran the Alien RPG, we were basically like a blue-collar, roughneck crew zipping around space, having adventures, and we barely encountered xenomorphs. And Matt, you know, he did the smart thing. It was the climax to the campaign. Involved that, but otherwise it just wasn't part of the setting, and we were thrilled, I think, for that development. I think we all kind of liked the way it ran. But here, you know, that's going to be a big part of what you're doing in this story. At some point, somehow, you're going to get involved with the lore that is inherent to the Alien universe. So in my mind, maybe if I were running it, like, maybe the 2D6 system as a whole is too much, and maybe the Alien system from Free League is the right level of crunch, but maybe the secret sauce is taking details from Hostel, because again, I'd want to lose the aliens and just make it that grit. Using these solo tables, which, you know, those solo tables are not, like, system specific. They could be basically anything, right? Maybe some of the stats are solo specific, but, you know, you can, no, like, protect executive sense of colony. Like, there is nothing, roll with D6 every 6 hours on an 8, you know, you could use these anywhere, right? So I don't know, like, if I were to do it, maybe that would be the trick. I don't know. But in my mind, like, even though this is about Hostel, there is a connection to be made here in my mind, because if I were running it, I might switch systems and use the material here. Or maybe the trick is M-Space, because that gives you starship design. It gives you everything that the 2D6 system does, but it's sort of a little bit more streamlined, a little more unified in its mechanics. I'm not really sure. But that's why I did want to at least mention this, because I feel like it's definitely doing something similar to Hostel. And it's a setting, it's a licensed setting, which Hostel doesn't have that luxury. But I feel like because Hostel's not licensed, it really goes out of its way to provide you with, like, just a wealth of detail of running and living in a gritty science fiction setting. And I think to that end, I don't know of another system personally, or another setting book, that goes that far. Except maybe the actual answer is GURPS Transhuman Space. Maybe that's the one I want all along. You know, it's all within our solar system. If there's anything you can say about GURPS books, is that there's just an overwhelming, crushing amount of detail. Transhuman Space is no different. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. In the end, though, I guess you get the Hostel setting, definitely. I would get Hostel solo. I got the Cepheus Deluxe Kickstarter, but maybe I should get the Hostel rulebook as well, just to make sure there's not something there I could really make use of. Again, this is me talking myself into the more books I have, the better. Cepheus Deluxe is just, it's a very detailed Traveler first edition Mongoose game. And so I get a little intimidated by it. Part of me would love to run it someday, but that's why I start looking at, you know, get that sort of look over there at the alien building better worlds, and maybe like, you know, maybe I'm not smart enough for this system, but I might almost be smart enough to run a free league. Sorry, I keep forgetting my mics here. So anyway, this has been a look at Hostel. Again, you need Hostel, the setting. You either need to get the Hostel rulebook, you need to get some version of the Cepheus rules. There are versions of it that are free on DriveThru. All of them are available on DriveThru. Cepheus Deluxe is the most recent one. Stella Gamma Publishing. This is going to be the most complete. It's going to be the most advanced, if that's what you're looking for. I know there's like a whole series of them, but I can't tell you offhand what they're called. So, all in all, if you're looking for a sci-fi setting, rule set, I think the last couple of books we've looked at, whether it's the M-Space setting, that gives you everything you need in a D100, if that's your jam, a manageable, sort of consistent rule set. But it doesn't give you, once you bring in like the Elevation books, it gives you a certain kind of sci-fi setting, which to me is a little bit like The Expanse. And The Expanse has some grit to it, but Elevation is not that gritty. What I was always after, and what I got when Matt ran Alien and basically didn't have aliens in it for the most part, was exactly what I'd always wanted in a sci-fi role-playing game. And so I started to research, like, what's out there? And then that's how I came across Hostel. And someday I would love to run Hostel. It's exactly what I'm personally looking for in a sci-fi setting. Retro tech, gritty, dark, grunty, you know, dirty. And I don't know if there is another setting that I've encountered that is so fleshed out in terms of detail. Not narrative detail, but like, you know, how does this work? What is this like? You know, just the day-to-day minutiae. And it just gives you tons of detail and really captures what I'm looking for in a sci-fi setting, even if, you know, I can sometimes sort of see a coat of paint scraping off and it's just alien underneath a little bit, you know what I mean? That doesn't stop me from really appreciating the setting, really appreciating all the detail and the information and so many supplements. It's just, if there's some aspect of this kind of setting that you're interested in, I almost guarantee you there is a book you can buy to flesh it out. Might be an exaggeration, but you know what I'm saying, right? And, you know, and one of the things, Zozer, I don't have it with me, but they have a game called Orbital 2100. It's like a precursor, I guess you could call it that, to Hostel. If you're looking for this kind of hard sci-fi, detailed, within our solar system kind of setting, Orbital 2100's out there as well. I don't know if they have like tons of adventures, although they do have, well, I won't get into that. That's a whole different thing. So between M-Space and Hostel, you know, I won't say pick one or the other, right? They do enough things differently. And if you have a background in Traveler, you might be able to jump right into Hostel a lot quicker. And I feel like this has a vision of what it wants to be, and it goes after it really, really well. Where M-Space, I feel like, wants to give you a toolkit, and it does that really, really well. Anyway, again, Hostel, Zozer Games, I'll have the link of where to get it in the show notes. If this is the kind of sci-fi you're looking to run, highly recommend it. And give the setting book at least a look. Even if you're sitting going like, oh, this feels like it's a bit of a copy of this or that, just seeing the amount of information that they give you, I think can really spark a lot of ideas. So once again, this has been Black Lodge Trivia Night doing a Bookhouse Boys. We are basically a tabletop RPG and discussion podcast. Here's sort of one of the discussions. If you prefer audio versions of this, just search for Black Lodge Trivia Night where we get your podcast. We should show up. If you're watching this, you've already found our YouTube channel. If you enjoy this kind of thing, like, subscribe, leave comments, whatever you want to do. If you want to jump into the Discord and discuss this kind of stuff, we talk about tabletop RPGs. We talk about computer RPGs a little bit less frequently, but they are there. The Discord link should be in the show notes as well. And there's something else I was going to say, but I guess it's not that important. But thank you again for checking this out. We always appreciate it. And we'll talk again soon. Again, we have some games running right now. My Mithras Imperative at the time of this recording, Cold War Spy. Matt's prepping some Delta Green, I think. Patrick's running some Eat the Reich. It's entering spooky season, so I can tell you there's going to be hopefully some more liminal horror. Matt and I started that. Hopefully we can wrap that up or at least continue that as well. So yeah, a lot of different RPGs going on. And we hope that if you're interested, you check them out. So thanks again. Take care and talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
The music during the RPG session in Foundry was provided by the Foundry module Tabletop RPG Music and composed by Ian Fisher. You can find his Patreon at www.patreon.com/tabletoprpgmusic, all one word.